lot of fun with it. What? I said I'm having a lot of fun with it.
Well, amen to that. Wow, you're a good-looking bunch this morning. I wish you guys could see what I see. You guys look good this morning. Well, welcome to each and every one of you. Aren't you thankful you got up and came to church this morning? I'm excited for what the Lord wants to do here this morning. Before I make a quick few announcements, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just come before you this morning. Lord, so grateful and so thankful that Lord, you carried us through another week, and Lord, you have been faithful to us every single day of this past week. So, Father, today as we gather today to worship you and to look into your word and pray together and sing together, sing praises to you, Father, it is our prayer that as your spirit has been here ready and waiting, that we will come ready with our cups turned right side up so that you can fill us to overflowing. So, Father, we just ask that you move in your own way throughout this service. And, Father, we just want to pray that this service will be pleasing in your sight, and, Father, that whatever we say and whatever we do, that you'll get all the praise and that you'll get all the glory and that your will be accomplished in this place today. Father, we love you and we praise you and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And everybody says together, amen. Well, just a couple announcements. I'm sure all of you have a bulletin. There's many different dates, many different happenings going on. I do want to point your attention to this coming Wednesday. Anybody know what's going on this coming Wednesday? Yeah, Wednesday Recharge. Our Wednesday night ministries for all ages will be beginning. There will be children and youth, and I believe for this Wednesday and next Wednesday, the children will be meeting at 6:30. Starting at 6:30, they're going to go through their quizzing review over the next 2 weeks. And but also at 7 o'clock, or 6:30, I guess the youth are starting as well, if I remember right, 6:30. And the adults will be meeting from 7 to 8. We're going to start right here in the sanctuary, and I just want to let you know, for the adults, I'm going to be leading. That's scary, isn't it? I'm going to lead you again down a road. No, it's going to be a great road. It's going to be a great time of discussion, a great time of learning, a great time of fellowship. And maybe some of you are maybe wrestling with, well, should I go or shouldn't I go? The setting is going to be very relaxed, very comfortable. I'm going to get lazy boys for everybody. Right. Not really. Not really. But it will be a very comfortable setting, and we're just going to gather, we're going to fellowship, we're going to study together, we're going to have discussions together. And if you're wrestling with maybe, I don't know if I want to be in the middle of a discussion group or all that stuff, just know that I'm the kind of, I'll use the language of Mike Cumpson, our men's director. When I facilitate, I don't force anybody to talk, and I don't point you out in the crowd. So just know you can come and be comfortable. And if you just want to come and take in and be quiet, that is absolutely fine. But if you want to participate, that's open as well. So that's Wednesday nights from 7 to 8. Looking forward to that. Couple things. Next, just a reminder, next Sunday we will be having something different. Sunday evening at 5 o'clock, we'll be having a soup and sandwich meal together with some missionaries from Papua New Guinea. And that will be next Sunday, 5 o'clock. We'll meet here. And at 6 o'clock, we'll be having our service with the missionaries. They're going to be sharing with us what's going on in Papua New Guinea. So that'll be a great time of fellowship and a great time of learning about missions. I got some new news from the Sheriff's Department as far as the CRCC class that we are having on February 29th. Many of you have been to the back and you have signed up for that class. Many from the community have already signed up. But they did inform me this week that class is for 13 and older because a lot of the sensitive topics and different things that will be discussed in that when it pertains to active shooters and all that stuff. So I know some of you were asking about age groups, 13 and older for the class. So I wanted to make that note. And this week in the mail, I got a really cool card. It was an invitation from Pastor George and Gloris Stevenson. Everybody remembers George and Gloris. In fact, if you remember last week, I made reference to Pastor George and I tried to imitate his voice. He texted me Sunday evening and informed me that if I'm going to try his voice, I need to work a lot harder. So they were with us last Sunday. They were live streaming and watching it. So he called me out on my imitation. So, but on Saturday, February 15th at 12 noon, their family is putting on a 60th wedding anniversary party for George and Gloris. The family has invited the Wynn family to come, as they would love to see a great turnout from the Wynn family, because George and Gloris just adore all of y'all. And so that's Saturday, February 15th, 12 noon. I will post it on the church Facebook, and maybe I'll have Sharon send out an email this week just as a reminder. But I have to have an RSVP for the family by Wednesday. So if you could contact me by Wednesday and let me know if you got that on your calendar and you want to be a part of that, kind of give me a head count as to your family and all that so I can RSVP as a group to the family. What's that? Oh, yeah, it will be in Roanoke. And since I forgot to bring the invitation with me, I can't remember the name of the church, but I will have that posted and we'll put that out in an email as well this week. So it is in Roanoke. So I think that'll be a great time. We all love George and Gloris, two amazing people. Amen. All right, well, with that said, I think that's all the announcements. So at this time, speaking of missions, we'll let our kids get ready for missions and come collect all your loose change. So I don't even have to tell you to go. You just go.
With us this morning. Sweet.
Love that. Amen. Hey, you guys just witnessed something. I made my first mistake of the new year. It had to happen. But now I got to go all these months because you know, I only make one mistake a year. Well, I had the date wrong on George and Gloris's party. I'm supposed to RSVP by January 15th, and that's where I got the 15 in my head. It's actually Saturday, February 8th is the party. So Saturday, February 8th, and like I said, we'll have that posted and sent out and everything this week. So as we continue our worship this morning, I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward as we give this morning. Let us pray together. Father, we just count it a privilege once again to come before you, Lord. And Father, we're just so thankful and so grateful for your love and for your blessings. But most of all, we're thankful for your Son, Jesus, in our lives. Father, we're thankful for your watch, your care, and protection in our lives. And Father, for how you just pay attention to every little detail of our own individual life. Truly, we are a blessed people this morning. So Father, as we worship through giving this morning, it is my prayer that you will just bless each gift, that you will bless each giver. And Father, that you'll bless and multiply these offerings to further your kingdom at Winchester and beyond. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name, and all God's people say together, amen.
Well, I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord today. I thank the Lord for another day of life that he's given us today. And as we've come into a new year, and we've just come through the holiday Christmas season, we reflected on the birth of Jesus Christ. And this song that I'm going to sing today reflects back on the Christmas season, but more importantly, it talks about worshiping the light of the world that came into the world when it was in darkness, and how we are to worship the light and honor Jesus Christ in everything that we do and say, and be that light out in this world, because there's still darkness out in the world today, and we need to let our light shine. So listen to the words of this song today.
Who would have thought that one bright star over tiny Bethlehem would bring a light that shines around the world? And the light from that first holy night still warms the heart today as we celebrate. We join our hearts and sing. Oh light of the world, we worship you. Oh light of the world, we honor you. As we journey through this cold, dark world, we will care. Like a candle in the darkness, your light dispels the fear of what is waiting in the dark unknown. As you shine your light around us, by faith our hearts can see the road we walk will one day lead us home. Oh light of the world, we worship you. Oh light of the world, we honor you. As we journey through this cold, dark world, we will care. To light up the world with the light of the world. Shine your light in the places that no one else can see. Holy light of the ages, shine your light through me. Oh. As we journey through this cold, dark world, we will carry you to light up the world with the light of the world. As we journey through this cold, dark world, we will carry you to light up the world with the light of the world.
In Ezekiel, it talks about the Lord bringing Ezekiel into the valley of dry bones. And before he does that, he says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow the decrees and be careful to keep my laws. And our win prayer, if you saw in the bulletin last week, part of it says, today we ask you to breathe life into areas that are sick and dying. Like Ezekiel, bring dry bones back to life, we pray. Let's stand and sing and pray to the Lord that he will give us that life again.
Sure.
Corinthians 12:9 says, "But he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me.'"
So remember.
seated.
All right, kids, you may be dismissed at this time. And there they go. All right, open your Bibles, if you will, to Ephesians chapter 4, and we're going to continue on this whole theme of walk a life that is worthy of the calling. And as you're turning there, don't you just love how God works? Let me just ask you that question. Don't you just love how God works? Don't you love how He listens to everything that we have to say? Aren't you thankful He leans His ear into each one of us? And aren't you thankful that He has a sense of humor? God is a funny guy, amen? He has got a wonderful sense of humor. One of the things I really enjoyed about this past week, aren't you thankful God was faithful this past week just like He is every other week? But you know, I asked that question last week and we got that little side rabbit trail about the weather, and I divided the church between those who wanted snow and those who did not, and I talked about how warm it was. Don't you love the fact that for 2 days we had winter and we actually had white stuff on the ground? God loves your pastor, okay? But He also loves the rest of you heathens that don't like snow, because we went right back to the warmth and to the sunshine. Isn't it beautiful out today? It is just absolutely gorgeous outside. I just love how God works, and I'm just chuckling right along with Him, because when that snow hit, my phone blew up. What was that, Tuesday? It was either phone. I think somebody, Melissa, I think you posted on Facebook, hey, PD, how about your snow or whatever, but God is faithful to us, amen? And all of us that were divided, we all got what we wanted, amen? That's just how God works. We all got what we wanted. And, of course, I'm ready for more snow. 7 days a week. Okay, we won't go there. And I also love the fact that, boy, there are several of you that listened to me last week, because you've flipped aisles on me. You've changed seats. And I totally forgot about that challenge last week, and I said something to somebody sitting over here. And then it went up row by row. We're over here too. We're over here too. Oh, because I challenge y'all maybe to change seats just for fun. And some of you are having a blast today. I'm kind of unbalanced on how to preach, where to stand, what to do, because you're not in your same seat. Can we have that in church? Can we actually change seats? Never done it that way before. Anyways, hey, just a quick review in case you missed last week or were napping or whatever the case might have been. But Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. Let's just run through that real quick again, because we got to have the foundation of which today is built upon, because today is part 2 of last week. Aren't you thankful I cut it into two parts after I preached well past noon last week? Don't you dare say amen. If you say amen to that, you need to be at this altar right now. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 16, unity in the body of Christ. This is what we looked at last week. This is where we hung our hat. But verse 1, as a prisoner for the Lord, Paul writes, then I urge you to live a life that is worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble, be gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when He ascended on high, He led captives in His train and gave gifts to men. What does He ascended mean except that He descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fulfill the whole universe. Verse 11, it was He who made some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Verse 14, then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of men who in their deceitful scheming, instead speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into Him who is the head, that is Christ. From Him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. Every body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. That's all of us together. We all need one another. Amen. So last week we took a quick look at verses 1 through 3 about how Paul is telling us that we are called to one body. We are called to one mission. We are called to one vision. We are called to be a body of believers that are one under Him, right? One God, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Can I get an amen? We have been called to this unifying factor that is the one body. We took a quick look in verses 4 through, well, a long look through verses 4 through 6. The grounds for this unity are listed in these three verses. You will note that the central item, as I just said, is that one Lord. This one Lord, this one faith, this one baptism. And as Paul adds, and I love this, this gives us reassurance, one God and Father of all who is over all and through all and in all. And I am thankful this morning that God is in all the details in all of our lives. Verses 7 through 11 of last week. The gifts for the unity in the church are given in these verses. Christ ascended and he gave these gifts as he saw fit. Now, if I was leading the praise team, you guys would wish and pray that the praise time would hurry up and be over with. Because I'm just not gifted to lead singing. But I'm thankful for the group that we have this morning. I'm thankful for the songs that we have this morning. I'm thankful for that time that we shared in that worship this morning. It was an amazing time. I felt the presence. And again, one of those songs, Standing on the Promises, it kind of goes along with the leaning. How many did you guys? That sounded really good, didn't it? I was looking out of the corner of my eye, and once again, it's one of those songs, Everybody Sways. It's a swayer song. And I noticed the praise team's up here swaying. The only one I didn't see swaying was the one on display back here. Did you like the new exhibit? Poor Fred was outnumbered by all these women up here today. We had to put a cage between him and them. So, but that spirit of worship. Teaching. Some people are equipped and gifted to teach. I understand through coming to Winchester, some people are gifted in the facilitation. But these gifts are given as God sees fit. But all these gifts need to be put together for one purpose. Amen? And that's honoring and serving Him and equipping the saints for service. Verses 12 through 16. This is the goal of the church that is described in these verses. The pastor is to equip and nourish the saints for the word of God, equip them for service. And what do the saints do in turn? They go work, and they perform the works of service. As each saint grows and wins others, what happens to the body of Christ? It's edified. It grows. Amen? And one of my favorite theologians, Warren Wiersbe, he wrote, "For the maturing of the saints into the work of the ministry, unto the building of the body of Christ, each, everyone, all saint shares in the growth of the church." But Paul writes in verse 14, there are some Christians who are still babies. And I didn't spend a ton of time there last week because that is where we're going to kind of be today. But we have an enemy out there. And let's be real about our enemy, okay? He's real. He is real. Can I say he's really real? And I'm telling you right now, he wants nothing more than to see this church just fall apart. He wants nothing more than to see all the churches on Valley Drive, and there's a lot of churches if you drive down through here. Satan would love nothing more than to see every single one of those churches crumble. He's the father of all lies. He's the father of all schemes, and guess what? He's got a target. You know where it's at? It's you. We have an enemy that is real. This is why we have to grow in God's Word. This is why we have to be faithful in all things of God, all service to God. This is why we need to grow and learn and mature in our faith. This is why, ladies and gentlemen, we have to study the Word of God. so that we can be equipped, so we can have strength, so we can have a backbone, so that we can have a shield around us, because I'm telling you, the enemy is coming. Well, Pastor, I'm exempt from the enemy. I don't feel him. Well, maybe he's got you where he wants you, and he doesn't have to come at you. Amen? The church is the body of Christ, and it needs feeding. It needs to feed on the holy word of God, period. Amen? Now, all these devotional books and all these little side studies, all those things out there, those are all well and good, and those are written by people of the world who are great people of faith. But it's always got to be the Bible first. First. Don't want to leave this section out. First. Amen? We need the Word of God. We've got to be built up in the body of Christ, and we've got to feed on what's good, perfect, right. So, in the closing of last week, and then we're going to go back to this whole thought of some Christians can still be babies. There, I got a wah. Did you know just because somebody calls himself a Christian, that does not make them spiritually mature? Did you know that even many people can digest all of the Word of God and understand it from front to cover and still be a baby? Wow. You know what that means, right? They have a lot of Bible knowledge, but they've not let the Word of God permeate their heart and change them from the inside out. I have met many people through the years that know a lot about the Bible but don't know how to live it. I don't know about you, but I'd like to be one considered of one who lived it. Amen? Needs to be the example of our life. So I gave this challenge last week. I started to go into a little sermon as into what I was doing today. I got to stay on track here. I challenged you guys last week with the mission of the church. We have this mission. We have this vision. And I asked you the question, what would happen if you did your part? Well, I asked you a ton of questions, but I'm narrowing it down today to two. What would happen if you did your part? And then it comes down to what would happen if everybody did their part. Imagine what would happen in the church. This church, and let's just say the church universal. If we became the believers that God desired for us to be, the followers that He desired for us to be, the servants that He needed us to be, universally as a whole, wow. Do you guys think we could be on the verge of revival in this country and around the world? If every church became what God desired for them to be, folks, there'd be a fire going on. There would be a fire going on. What would happen if you did your part? What would happen if everybody did your part? It did their part? That requires a change. And just one quick reminder, I got to show the video again to help lead into today. What if you meant it this year?
This year, I mean it. I mean it.
I could not possibly mean it anymore.
I got this.
Candy bars, gone. Funyuns, gone. Ice cream, candy bars and Funyuns are gone.
This year, I'm gonna connect with people IRL. In real life.
Made a list. That means I mean it.
I'm gonna take care of myself. Right after I figure out who that is, other than a mom, which I love.
I beat myself up. I'm never good enough. That has to change. Why do I do that? I'm such an idiot. See?
This year I'm gonna work on being the cool dad, you know? Maybe go to the skate park, hang out with my kids. No biggie. This works, right?
I gotta learn to forgive myself. You know, give myself a break. Not be perfect. I've got it. I'm gonna step outside of my comfort zone by volunteering at the hospital. Maybe the pet shelter, because cats, they're so much easier. This year, I'm gonna forgive my mom. Now that I am a mom, I totally get it.
This year, I'm gonna start reading literature, you know, books and such, because I hear it's good for me.
This year, I'm shaving my back hair. I am tired of those kids at the neighborhood pool calling me Sasquatch.
A It's just that I am comfortable staying in my comfort zone.
Who am I kidding? God, I wear myself out, trying to outdo everyone. I can one-up everything, and it's exhausting.
I have a lot of baggage, and it is not all from the mall. Well, some of it is. I'm trying, God, I am. But there's a reason why I'd rather stay at home.
I'm weak, God. I know it. You know it.
And you know what, God? This year, I'm giving you all the places that hurt.
I'm gonna give you all of my failed attempts that I think are gonna make me a better man.
You are a strong fortress, God. You. And I'm gonna let you be strong in my weakness.
All right, God. I'm gonna start with the best relationship. You and me. And then we'll move outward from there. Because this year, I mean it.
I mean it.
I mean it.
I mean it.
So what if this year you did truly mean it? What if this is the year you said, every day I'm gonna get into the Word? And then you got into the Word every day. I'm going to guarantee you, you'll be a much better follower of Jesus Christ than you were last year. What if you decided this year I'm going to pray more? And you prayed and you meant it and you did 365 daily multiple prayers throughout the year. You became a mighty prayer warrior. This was the year that changed your life. The more time you spend in prayer, I'm going to tell you right now, God will mold you and shape you and change you. And you'll be way better as a follower of Jesus Christ than you were last year. What if this year you said, you know, I mean it. I'm going to be a follower in the church like God wants me. I'm going to serve like I have never served before. And you meant it. And you became a servant of Jesus Christ like you never have before. Let me tell you, you're going to be a much better follower of Jesus Christ than you were last year. What if you said this year, you know, I'm going to worship like I've never worshiped before. And you meant it. And you did it. You sang out in your car. Sometimes we have to sing in our cars because you don't want anybody else to hear that voice. But God has this really cool filter in his ears. You may call yourself a horrible singer, but by the time it reaches his ears, it's a beautiful sound. What if you worship like you never have before because you decided this year I'm going to be a worshiper? Let me tell you, you're going to be a way better follower of Jesus Christ than you were last year. What if you decided, you know, this year I'm going to be more faithful in my attendance to the church? And you meant it. And you did it. Good job for many of you. Guess what? In 2020, you've been at church every Sunday. Some of you made it to two services already. Good job. You're on a roll. Keep it going. But what if you decided, hey, I'm going to be faithful in my attendance like I never have before? And you meant it and you did it. Guess what? Next year at this time, you're going to be a way better Christian than you were today. Amen. I could just keep on going, but I think we kind of get the point that if we mean it and we follow like we mean it, we believe like we mean it, we serve like we on all the above, God has got a blessing in store for you like you never would have imagined, because that's just the way God is. So we have this calling in our life, and last week we looked at the calling, we looked at our relationship to the church, and I issued challenges, and we looked at in Paul's letter, as a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And that was with the relationship to the church. I hope and pray that you are earnestly praying for your church this year. I hope that you are earnestly praying for your pastor this year. Boy, does he ever need it. I hope that you are praying earnestly for your pastor's wife this year, because boy, she has to live with him. See? How's come I get more amens on that? But this week, Ephesians chapter 4, we're going to continue on in this letter that Paul has written. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 through 32, we're going to look at the relationship to the world. Now, as I've been praying about this and studying through this over the past month, I've been wondering why in the world, Paul must be a little bit ADD like myself. I would think if you're going to write a letter and you're going to talk about the relationship to the church, that should come after the relationship to the world, because it's the world that sets us back. Amen? No? No. You set yourself back. we talked about in Sunday school this morning, right? For those of us that came to Sunday school this morning, self causes self to rebel. Self causes self to backslide. Self causes self to make the bad choices. Self causes self to become lackadaisical in our walk and in our journey. Can I get an amen? So I would think that Paul would say, you know what? Let's work on sharpening who they are in Christ Jesus. And then we'll talk about this commitment thing to the church. So I find it kind of funny that he must have been having an ADD moment. He had so many things on his brain as he was under this house arrest. And he had so many things to say. Did you guys know that pastors go on rabbit trails? Shannon, oh yeah. You must have been talking about some other pastor, right? Because I know I don't go on rabbit trails at all. He must have had so many things that he wanted to say, and he just started writing. You know, and he's writing us about this relationship to the church. How we should, what we should do, how we should live, and how we should commit, and on and on and on and on. But then he's thinking, oh yeah, they should probably sharpen themselves up before we talk about this thing in the church. Well, I'm just going to throw it all together anyways and just let the preacher sort it out. Amen? So this week, this relationship to the world, let's look in verses, starting in verse 17, we see this transition. My heading says, living as children of light. Paul writes, so I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer, I think he should have capitalized this. I think he should have underlined it. I think he should have highlighted it. That you must no longer live as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity with a continual lust for more. Verse 20, you, however, did not come to know Christ that way. Surely you heard of him and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Verse 25, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs. And if it benefit any those who listen, and do not grieve the Holy Spirit with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. Well, I think we kind of sense and get a picture of maybe why he put this whole part after the relationship to the church. We were supposed to have learned and been equipped in a new way, right? So maybe the theme of this letter is, hey, you've been hearing the word, you've been hearing the lessons, you've been hearing the preacher ramble on and on and on about such a thing, and you went through the Sunday school classes, you went through the life groups, you sat through the worship services. So what I'm seeing is there should be some kind of change. So maybe this is serving as a general reminder of the things that we need to put off. The things that we need to do away with. You guys are a quiet bunch this morning. Are you guys worried that I might go to 1201? Guess what? Well, I'll have you out of here by 1, okay? We have to know that there has to be a change if we are learning. If we are allowing the Word of God to hit our ears, there should be something changing here. There should be something changing in our spirits. Well, we should just flat out be different, right? So Paul transitions this portion of the letter, and the first part of the chapter, he's talking about that relationship to the church, but today we're looking at this portion of the letter, and he kind of starts off with a little bit of a negative attitude. He basically just says, do not walk in the way of the unsaved person. Do not walk in the way of those that have hardened their hearts, because if you have listened to the lesson, if you allow God to permeate your heart and your very being and your spirit, there should be some, you shouldn't be like them. So he's saying, don't walk in that way. Isn't it sad, church, that the church of today has a reputation for kicking their own when they're down? Some of you look like you're shocked by that. Maybe some of you have just been here. I'm thankful that we all love one another here. As we were going through this last week, and I talked to you all in that sermon about the spirit of unity, there is not one perfectly unified church this side of eternity. Can we all agree on that? Because we're all just people, right? And we all know that people cause more trouble than anyone. And people get on your nerves. I was waiting for an amen. People just flat out get on your nerves. And we are a group full of people, a room full of people right now. Amen? Pastor Dan, you're getting on my nerves right now. Not really. I just want to see if you guys will look over at him. He's like, what did I do? Something should change in our very being. Something should change in our spirit. And as I shared last week, Paul, he's charged up when he's writing this letter, and he has that alone time because he's basically under arrest, and he is sitting still, and I'm sure his mind is just racing because his pastor's heart is just full of a passion to be with his people. But if he can't physically be with his people, he's going to make sure he's still with his people, and he starts writing. He starts pinning these things down. He starts thinking through these things. He starts praying through these things, and he has a passion that is burning because he wants nothing but good for his church and his people. Kind of like God. He wants nothing but good for his people and his church. Amen? Aren't you thankful we have a God that is that loving and that graceful? So he starts with the negative. He says, don't walk in the way of the world. You may have to be in the world. Look around, folks. We are in the world, but we don't have to be of it. We don't have to be of it. We don't have to resemble it. Amen? We don't have to be a twin to the world today. And he explains the reasons for this godless walk of the world around him. He says, one, basically, their minds are darkened. Their minds are darkened because they believe lies. They believe lies and have not received the truth. A few moments ago, I talked to you about the enemy. We all agreed the enemy is real. He's the master deceiver. He's the author of all lies. He's the author of all chaos and all confusion. So he's saying their minds are darkened because they believe lies and have not received the truth. Can we just kind of flip side that a little bit? You've heard the truth. As people in Christ Jesus, you've had the... You're sitting here today, and I'm telling you right now, I'm preaching truth. You know how I know that? Because my Bible's open. We're not to believe what the world tells us. We're to believe what our God tells us. He also goes on to say, the world around you is spiritually dead. What's the condition of our world today? Folks, it is spiritually dead. Amen? That's why we're seeing what we're seeing. That's why we're seeing this moral decline. That's why we see value. What's a value? Right? We're seeing moral values go by the wayside. We're seeing a generation brought up to have no moral code. Our young people today, all they're being filled with is an immoral code. Amen? This immoral code, I used the word last week. Let's just say it again because we'll just call it like it is. Sin is sin, right? And the world is telling the world to accept it. The world is telling everybody to accept it. Folks, we even got religious leaders caving to this concept that the world is getting. This is what Paul is writing about. Boy, if this letter is more pertinent today than it was back then even. The moral decline is sickening. It's saddening. It's heartbreaking. When we start seeing our churches get away from the truth, No wonder Paul was all, oh man. They were spiritually dead. Tammy alluded to it when she shared scripture this morning about the hardened heart, and we see it in our text for today as well. This hardened heart. I'm thankful that we have a God who comes alongside and He can bring new life to a hardened heart. What did He say in that text, if you remember what she said? I will put my what in you. Put my spirit in you, God says. Right. Isn't that a great concept? You're walking through this life. Things have been hard. You're downtrodden. Your faith, your joy, it's all zapped. And you're starting to feel bitter. You're starting to feel angry. But God comes alongside you and He gives us this beautiful gift and He says, hey, I want to put my spirit in you. And when God works His spirit into our lives, your circumstance changes. You become joyful again. You start to experience peace again. You start to feel whole again. Because that's just the way God is. When He puts His spirit in you, there is a healing and there is a cleansing that takes place. And if we open ourselves to God and we allow His Spirit to work in and through us, there is a transformation of spirit, heart, and mind. And this is kind of what Paul's saying. He says, you've heard this. You've heard this. You've heard this. When are you going to allow it to work in you? He writes this letter. And he says, these people have surrendered themselves. They've surrendered themselves to all kinds of sin. I'm paraphrasing here, but the world around us has caved to all kinds of sin. We can say they're walking in the wrong way because they didn't know the truth and never had received life. You know how you receive life? There's only one way. John 14:6. Jesus says what? I am the way, the truth, and what? The life. So if Jesus is the only way, if He is the only truth, guess what? He is the only life. New life happens in Christ Jesus. Jesus also goes on to say, at the tail end of that, I'm the way, the truth, the life. No one gets to the Father but through me, you can't do it at the Walmart. They don't sell it on a shelf. You can't go to the Way, Truth, and the Life department and pay $39.95 for it. I think it's Walmart. They use 97 cents, so $39.97. It's true. You can't go buy the Way, the Truth, and the Life. You can't order it on Amazon Prime. And we know Amazon will deliver anything now. Had a moment last night where I just happened to check something on Amazon. Rabbit trail. If you ever live in Texas, you will learn what Whataburger is all about. Has anybody ever had Whataburger here? Now, you're from Oklahoma. Okay. Yes. You. Whataburger, I'm telling you, I'm not advocating for grease, but it is good fast food. And I just had a moment last night where I'm like, one of the things I liked at Whataburger is the spicy ketchup. They have the best spicy ketchup. Fred, we should get together because you can order on Amazon. We could split the cost. I looked up Whataburger spicy ketchup last night to see if you could order it. You can. It's pretty cool. If you walk out of here today, try to remember the sermon, not spicy ketchup. So basically what Paul is telling us today, or telling the Ephesians then, telling us today, the Christian life has to be radically different from the old life. Do you believe that? The Christian life must be radically different from the old life. I'm thankful I'm not the guy that I used to be. I'm thankful that you're not the people you used to be. I didn't know you back then, but from what your neighbor tells me. Just kidding. There has to be a shift. There has to be a change. There has to be a complete transformation from the inside out. When God comes along, puts his new spirit, his spirit in you, you become new. You should become changed. And if you're digesting the Word of God, which, let me tell you, is interpreted by what? The Holy Spirit, into your spirit, there is something sweet going on. There's a sweet fellowship that is going on. And if you're allowing yourself to be open and subject to that, woo, you're going to be an amazing person. Paul is saying there has got to be a radical change from the old life. Now, Paul expected them to experience changes, and he gave them three admonitions that we want to look at real quick today. Verse 22. I've lost my place. Verse 22. You were taught, he says, with regard to your former way of life, to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires. So he tells us to take that garment off. Put off that old self. A few months ago, I preached to y'all. We were looking at a couple of weeks into this amazing story of new life in Lazarus. When Jesus went to that tomb, what did he say? Lazarus, come forth. Remember, he'd been dead how many days? Yeah. Jesus steps onto the scene and says, Lazarus, he commands a dead man to come out of the tomb. Did Lazarus come out of the tomb? Yeah. New life. From death to life. So Paul is saying to us today, you need to take off that old garment. What happens after Lazarus comes out? Did Jesus say, keep the same clothes on? Take the grave clothes off because you no longer have a need for them, right? So we see where these two are coming together. If you are in Christ Jesus and you entered into the realm of Jesus, into your life, a new person comes, right? Do you want to keep on the old self? Do you want to keep on the old garment of sin? Do you want to keep on the old garment of grumpiness and joylessness and blah, 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 right? Do you want to keep all that negative attached to you? No, because with Jesus Christ, you are a new creation. When Jesus comes into your life, you are new again. And he's saying, take off the former self because I'm doing something new from here on out. Yeah. Can you hear me now? You should have seen the faces back here of the sound guys. He broke another one. In my defense, they had to change. And look at that clip. That's just not tight, guys. I can't have a fit like I used to. Because I've changed. That's right. So also, verse 24, let's move on. After we look at the put off the old self, verse 24, Paul also says, to be made new in the attitude of your minds and to put on the new self, catch it, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. So if you are taking off your old self, something new needs to be in your place or you're walking around naked. We don't want that. Put off your old self. So when you change clothes, what are you doing? You're putting on something new, something fresh, right? I was doing some painting, and I was sweating like crazy. What was that, Friday, I think it was. And I was just in the living room for a few minutes, and from all that sweating, Kathy basically told me I need to go get a shower. When you sweat, you stink, right? Unless you sweat like roses, I don't know. Coming from a dad with a house full of boys. You know, I did preteen camp once, and I had 12 boys, preteen boys, in my little tiny, I call it a lawn shed. It was a fancy lawn shed, basically. That was our little cabin. I'm going to tell you what now. Preteen boys, they stink. But I won clean cabin every single day because I was drill sergeant for a couple of reasons. One, if you got perfect rating on your cabin, you got to eat, you got to be, your group got to be first in the food line every single day. So if one, I wanted to be in the food line first every single day. I wanted choice and I wanted fresh. You with me? But that was one reason. Second reason was because they stunk. Before I went, somebody said, you should buy Lysol, and before they do the inspection, You Lysol every single bed. You Lysol the curtains, and when they walk in, they're going to smell this great fragrance. That's what I did. I went to Sam's Club and bought the industrial size can of Lysol. And folks, I'm telling you, every single day we got the flag. We won. First of all, here's the deal. Preteen boys stink really bad, and when you're sleeping and you're sucking in all that air, who wants to swallow preteen smell, right? If you walk out of here with nothing more today, please remember the sermon. But with Christ, you're putting off old garment which stinks, amen? And you're putting on something that is fresh and clean. If you're like me, when you pull out the fresh laundry, how many of you go, I like the smell of fresh laundry? When you put on those things, they smell good. Aren't you thankful that everybody showers before they come to church? Praise the Lord. But Paul is saying, put off the old self, which is the old life. The old life was full of sin, so the old life stinks. Put on something fresh and new because Jesus Christ has made you new. And when Jesus makes you new, folks, it's fresh. It's clean. And can I go cliche and say it's as white as snow? Amen? Paul also says, the third part of that, in verse 25, therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to his neighbor, for we are all members of one body. So what's the third one? Put off. Put away. You know what I love about my past life? When I came to Jesus, not only did I become new, but my past life, it's wadded up and thrown away. Where's it thrown into? The sea of forgetfulness. Now, just so you know, that's not my brain. The sea of forgetfulness is what it is, right? But it's not simply enough to die to the old life. There also has to be a resurrection of the heart. There also has to be a resurrection of the spirit. And there has to be a manifestation of new life on a continual basis. It's a beautiful cycle of newness. You know what? When I wake up tomorrow, my mercies are made new. Because that's just the grace of my God. That's just the grace of your God. And there's this cycle that I've talked about before. It's always ongoing. You wake up every single day with the choice on whether to jump in that cycle or not. I challenge you. Jump into the Jesus cycle. It will completely change your life. Every single one of us, we are a part of God's new creation. And therefore, if we are part of God's new creation, we should be walking in new life. We should be happier, right? We should be more joyful. We should be more graceful, except when you're driving. We should be more graceful all the time, amen? Just make sure you're still with me. We should put away once and for all. We cut up some vegetables the other day. You know, when you leave vegetables in a trash, when you're empty nesters, you don't throw trash bags away that often because it takes forever to fill up a trash can. But when you cut vegetables, you probably should make an adjustment to that schedule. We came home, whatever it was, Kathy says, man, our trash stinks. And I'm like, yeah, it does. What did we cut up? I got to thinking about it. It was the vegetables that we had cut up the other day. Well, that was the beginning of the week. Come on, man. Those things stink after 2 days. Put it away. We don't leave that in the house. We don't leave that around us. Paul say, get rid of the old life. Put it away. Paul also ties a commandment to his spiritual truth. We are members of one another. Verse 25. Put off the falsehood. Speak truthfully to the neighbor. If we are new in Christ Jesus, we don't talk like we used to. We don't think like we used to. We don't do things like we used to. Amen? We are new in Christ Jesus. If you're a regular liar, if you are in Christ Jesus, you should no longer be a liar. If you're a deceiver, no longer be a deceiver. If you're a gossiper, no longer should be a gossiper. You should be new in Christ Jesus because of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit working in and through you. Remember last week? the God over all and in all and through all. This holds true to all of this, folks. If you say you are in Christ Jesus, act like it. Ouch, Pastor, that kind of stung. If it stung you, maybe you've got some praying to do. Just being real. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, he begins with admonishing the Ephesians for us to live a life that is worthy of the calling. And This is all in the same chapter. It's all in the same letter. Live a life that is worthy of the calling. The calling to the church. This week, the calling of the world. We are in it. We don't have to be of it. Be the shining example that God needs you to be in this world. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1. I want to use it as today's end. He writes, be imitators of God. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Catch that. Be imitators of God. Is God holy? What should we be? Is God good? We should be good. Amen? He is the master transformer. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. There's a parallel here that I see in these words of Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1. Christ loved us. And what did he do? He gave himself up for us, so that we could be made new. Woo! So that we could be made new. What does John 3:16 tell us? For God so loved the world that he gave his one, catch it, his one and only Son, so that whosoever will believe in him will not, this is good stuff, will not perish, but have everlasting life. Wow. God so loved the world, he gave himself up for us so that we could be made new. Do you want to be new today? You want something new to strike your heart? Do you want something new to strike your spirit? Do you want something new to strike your life? Remember those words. It's simple. For God so loved you. For God so wanted to be a part of your life. For God so wanted to make you new. For God so wanted you to have joy. For God so wanted you to have peace. For God so wanted you to be blessed. He made a choice to give up his one and only perfect Son, so that you and everybody else would have new life, a new life that becomes everlasting, a new life that becomes eternal. Here's what I love. When you allow yourself to be made new in Jesus Christ, eternity gets so much better, and it starts right now. Eternal life starts right now through Christ Jesus. Because when folks who are in Christ Jesus die in Christ Jesus, they don't really die, because the promise is there's everlasting life. So what happens when believers die? We just get a whole new address. And the address is one word: glory. That's your choice today. Do I want to be new? Do I need restored? I want to give you the opportunity. The praise team's going to sing. We're going to have a time of prayer. I want you to just bow your heads as they sing. I want you to just pray. And if you need that today, I want to challenge you to come forward to these altars. I would love to just pray with you today.
Thank you.
that we can just surrender it all to Him each and every day. Let us pray together. Father, we thank You so much for this service today. Father, we thank You so much for Your love and Your grace and Your mercy. Father, we're thankful that You are the God who comes alongside us, and You will place within us a new spirit, Lord, that through You, all things are made new, and that includes every area of our life. So, Father, as we go from this place today, may we just surrender it all to You and be exactly what You need us to be as we go out into this world. May we be a shining light. May we be a shining example. May we be the reflection of Jesus Christ in the world around us. Father, I lift up those that came to this altar and had their special request. And Father, I just want to pray Your continuing touch upon them as they offered so much to You today. Father, maybe there were some who prayed from their seats. Father, we are thankful that You are the God who meets us right where we're at. Father, You heard the prayer of each heart in this place today. And we pray that You would intercede. Father, that You would bless, carry, and protect as we go from this place. Father, we love You and we praise You. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people say together, amen. Let us stand and sing together. God bless you. You have a wonderful week. Make sure you take a moment to greet those around you.